Welcome and thank you for tuning in. You're listening to the Beyond 50 radio program. I'm Daniel Davis. GMO foods, as many of us reach out for the packages in the store and even the produce section, we try to be sure that it says non-GMO. The question is how badly and how long have GMO foods affected the global food supply? While we can certainly know that it's contributed to a lot of food allergies that people seem to be on the rise with, as well as infertility among millennials, it's the third generation to be raised on eating genetically modified foods that have been sprayed by things such as herbicides and glyphosate. Our guest joining us here on the program today comes from a ranch environment where his roots were firmly established in agriculture. After attending a premier college preparatory school, Schreiner Institute in Kerrville, Texas, he went on to attend college at the University of Texas at Austin, where he studied cellular and molecular biology to become a business entrepreneur consultant in the soil fertility services. I'd like to welcome the Beyond 50 radio program today, our guest and founder of GEO Growers, Mr. George Altgelt. George, thank you for being back on the Beyond 50 radio program.
Well, actually, thank you. It's quite a privilege and an honor to be a guest on your show. Love the work that you're doing, and glad to be back.
Now, let's go ahead and talk about GMO foods. What specifically constitutes the nature of genetically modified foods? What is it exactly?
Well, the food itself has had genetic modifications that have been placed in it. They take microscopic particles of gold and they coat them with sections of DNA from things like viruses, which is the promoter gene, and then sections of gene from different plants or animals. And the promoter gene helps it to break into the cell and add its genetic material to the DNA strand so that you get that little section of DNA added to the strand. And the viral promoter gene, which is also part of the protocol for making this all happen, that's what facilitates getting it in there and getting it incorporated into the DNA. And people have heard things like, they wanted tomatoes that wouldn't freeze, so they put the DNA strand from an Arctic fish into the DNA of a tomato plant, and supposedly it would produce a tomato plant that wouldn't freeze. And I don't think they ever got anywhere with that one. And I'll give you some kind of uplifting information about that. When they were working on genetically modified potatoes, there was a scientist in Scotland, and I don't think this man was a Scottish person, just based on his name, but I don't know for sure. Arped Pusztai was doing research on genetically modified potatoes, and he did have some difficulty getting the rats to eat the genetically modified potatoes, but if you starved them long enough, they'd eat it, and then he started noticing genetic anomalies in the offspring, and especially if you went two or three generations downstream. In any event, he was authorized to talk about the work he was doing with this research company, and he made some statements that were public that he had grave misgivings about what was actually being produced by the potato itself because of the studies that he had done on rats. Well, he very quickly found himself in hot water with his company, and it didn't take but a few more days, he was put under a gag order not to say anything else because, after all, this was proprietary information. And then ultimately he lost his job along with some colleagues who had, you know, a lot of serious questions about genetic modification. And this was the first time that the public caught any kind of wind of a scientist being suppressed from actually saying what he had discovered. And the suppression was heavy. Whistleblowers of every kind have been, harassed, given crummy jobs, and then ultimately fired just for saying, I have misgivings about the way this research is being done. And that has happened throughout the history, and we're now into 30 years of history. We've got 91 is when the applications for GMOs in the United States were applied for. 92, we started seeing the first genetically modified plants. And then, things that have happened since then that would give you a pretty good idea of what this game is all about. And the game is having genetically modified foodstuffs being grown all over the world with the complete control and ownership of the people who are doing the genetic modification. And that would be Monsanto, and now that's Monsanto / Bayer, because Bayer bought Monsanto and bought the rights to a whole lot of things that they were producing. But if you want to look at the fruits, judge the fruit by, what you're seeing. And what you're seeing is a lot of small independent farmers being sued right out of business because of so-called patent infringements. And they have put quite a few farmers out of business. But I just wanted to give you some brief history because the cover-up has been extensive, and it's almost never covered in the media. These trials where glyphosate is being implicated in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is a blood disease generated by marrow, and we have good proof, good evidence that this is caused by glyphosate, also known as the herbicide Roundup. And I was going to do a little bit to explain how that occurs and why we know for sure that it is occurring. But that's pretty much the scope of what's going on with GMOs. It isn't to make sure we all have food in the future. It's really to own farming, to own food, and to own just about the ultimate control. There's a woman in India who was leading the resistance against the first Green Revolution, which she recognized very quickly as a way to sell lots more fertilizer and chemicals. And if you would, ask me about that again shortly, and I'll tell you why the chemicals are so necessary when you start using artificial fertilizers. But her name is Vandana Shiva, and she is the premier spokesperson of the folks in India who are leading the way to get GMOs out of India. And she's got a real good shot at that. And she's the one who has very quickly recognized the drawbacks, if you want to call it that, and that's being very polite, the drawbacks to GMOs in India. And her voice is quite sane, quite rational. She is quite articulate and quite able. And anybody that wants to look her up on the internet, I'm sure there's a lot of information about her. It's V-A-N-D-A-N-A, Vandana Shiva. And if that's misspelled, I'm sure Google will say, "Did you mean?" and give you the correct spelling. But anyway, that's the scope of it.
Well, it's pretty amazing that people are actually becoming more proactive about all this. I always have been one to say, look, if you don't want something to occur, don't sit around and wait to vote for it because your pocketbook votes pretty loud.
Absolutely. I'm so glad you said that. Mm-hmm. I am really happy to say that because one of the most uplifting things that's happened in this country is how the recombinant bovine growth hormone went into the trash as fast. We've never seen any such a beautiful response to getting rid of recombinant bovine growth hormone. And besides the fact that the consumers did not want to accept sex hormones in their milk, especially for their children, the dairy farmers noticed right away that the incidence of mastitis went way up. And of course, that means pus in the milk. And, you know, the strategy was, oh, well, let's just raise the temperature in the pasteurization process, and we don't have to worry about that. But they give the cows a whole lot more antibiotics to combat the mastitis, and it starts costing them. And the interesting thing about the recombinant bovine growth hormone, which was given to the dairy cows as an injection, it makes their hooves fall apart. Because of all these biological, autonomical, hormonal, molecular changes that occur in the dairy cow when you start administering this recombinant bovine growth hormone. The dairymen themselves rejected it. Not only were they noticing that the consumer didn't want it, but it's like what was supposed to be a boon of profit turned into a costly liability. Not just in terms of being of PR, but in terms of vet bills. You know, vets out there constantly, and it's not just the mastitis, it's the hooves falling apart, and then it's the reproduction capacity of the cow herself. You freshen the dairy cow by allowing her to get pregnant, and then she has a calf, and then she's ready to give milk again. Well, the reproduction problems showed up. They were so severe. There was, you know, this great increase in spontaneous abortions with the dairy cows themselves, and then other complications of actually birthing the calf. And, you know, dairy farmers are not really interested in having this kind of mayhem, you know, just running right through their dairy. They really would rather have, you know, a nice stable business where you milk the cows with all the modern conveniences, you know, their milking machines and all of that. But to have this kind of disease show up and to obviously be lied to by the representatives who were selling the RBGH, that gave great pause, and it has managed to make its way into the consciousness, even though the media doesn't like to cover it, won't cover it. And you may know this story also, and just pipe right up if you remember this. There was a news team that started investigating why all the backlash for RGBH milk. And they were working for Fox News. And boy, had they gathered up some really incriminating information, and they were in the middle of putting together this whole mini documentary, and Fox News squelched it, and ultimately those two reporters lost their job, and it's like, well, guess who's a big sponsor of what's on Fox News? And it's, you know, the very chemical companies that are promoting RGBH. And that came out in the documentary, and everyone should, you know, get a copy of this, you know, buy it, watch it on Netflix or wherever it might appear. It's The World, According to Monsanto. And that was very thoroughly covered in there. And not only the fact that their reporting was squelched, but also the fact that Monsanto itself had a great deal of evidence that RGBH was not good for the cows, and it was, in fact, producing milk that was significantly different from naturally produced milk. And the big difference was the IGF-1, which is a cancer-promoting, cancer-causing metabolic cofactor, and it was showing up in the milk. And that got a lot of people concerned because Monsanto gotten the Food and Drug Administration to say that there was no difference in the milk, yet the IGF-1 was climbing significant. And we already knew what the dangers of IGF-1 were. And that's the sort of thing that you're going to get a more in-depth explanation of if you see the movie The World According to Monsanto. Jeffrey Smith is one of the people interviewed in that movie. It's a movie documentary. It's enlightening, it's gripping, it's telling, and it's something all of the consumers out there need to see. Anyway, please go ahead if you remember.
No, it's really enjoyable to have you, share this with the listeners and to get people to, pay attention to what's going on out there and be at least discerning. And it's funny when people put so much credence into, pretty much any media, and usually they'll find one outlet, and that's where they get all their information. It's like, well, don't you think you ought to kind of bounce around and get more of a holistic view if you can? And if it's this much of a concern for you, then why don't you get out there and do the research yourself? Don't passively sit by and let everybody else do all this for you if it's a concern. But getting back to, again, choices, here, these companies seemingly have been allowed to do what they have been doing, which have obviously created problems. I've seen a lot of, for instance, commercials from law firms now that are going after Monsanto, apparently, because of Roundup and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So apparently the floodgate has been opened because of a lawsuit that apparently must have been won, because usually when a lawsuit is won due to wrongdoing, then all of a sudden everybody's after you. And at least, if nothing else, it isn't about collecting money, but the realization, hey, something's going on here we should be paying attention to make better choices about what it is that we do.
Exactly. Yeah. And by the way, one of these trials is being covered by a woman who's posting as Glyphosate Girl. And if you'll Google her, I think she'll come right up, and she's covering a trial, or has covered a trial, and is maybe covering another trial, and her postings are very telling. And of course, you've got to go to the internet to get that, because none of this is being covered in the media. But I do want to say this really interesting thing, because I want to get back to the upliftment. Various nurseries, and I remember here in Austin, Texas, Borden, a big milk company in Texas. They've been here since, the late 1800s, early 1900s. Anybody that had a dairy was probably selling to Borden in Texas. And big billboard shows up in Austin, Texas, and Borden is saying, Borden milk does not use or condone the use of RGBH in milk production. And, and it's like everybody's jumping up and down saying, oh boy, finally, finally the dairies are hearing us. And they were. And of course, Monsanto petitioned the Food and Drug Administration to, make it so they couldn't say that, and you couldn't put any kind of notification on the milk carton that said, we don't condone the use of RGBH and we don't allow it in any of the milk that we produce. Well, the FDA couldn't do that. I think there may have been some remote remnant of consciousness left within the Food and Drug Administration that kept them from doing it, but they did do Monsanto the favor of saying the Food and Drug Administration has determined that there is no significant difference between milk produced naturally and milk produced by RGBH. They got that on the container. And, I haven't seen that, that counter notice on milk lately, but I don't drink milk, so I have no idea, really and truly. But I do eat ice cream from time to time. And one of the very first commercial outfits that Monsanto went after was Ben & Jerry's ice cream. And Ben & Jerry's was probably the first, if not one of the first, ice cream producers to put on their package, we do not use milk produced with RGBH, recombinant bovine growth hormone used to produce the milk. And it was just right there on the container. Well, among the many things that were criticisms flung by Monsanto at Ben & Jerry's was, they're simply doing this for a PR promotional thing. It's all PR. And so then the interview goes to Ben & Jerry, and there they are talking about their ice cream. And Ben & Jerry are saying, yeah, you know, actually, it wasn't for PR. Actually, we want for our customers to survive, to not be exposed to the IGF-1 and all of the other factors, the hormones, the pus, and all the rest that gets into the milk when you use that RGBH. And the truth is, we want for our customers to survive and survive well, because here's the fact, dead people don't eat much ice cream.
That's true.
I thought
just
that
like,
was brilliant.
Who is it, Joel? There's a guy out there who's really been making a nice storm about that, Joel Wallach.
I know Joel Wallach. Dead doctors don't lie.
Yeah, dead doctors don't lie. And you know, he's quite a character as well. But, you know, there's a lot of truth about what a lot of these people are saying. I mean, it just takes a little bit of reason to go, something here that doesn't really occur in nature all of a sudden is being used. It's not really having a very good side effect for the most part on most people, not just a few people, but most people. It's time to really start making better decisions about what it is we allow and what we do. Now, I know when you take a look at, for instance, Europe, you know, they don't allow this kind of nonsense. Yeah,
no.
At all. And it's funny that we do. We're supposed to be the so-called powerful nation, but yet we're just kind of letting this all kind of push us around. We have a media, obviously, everybody points their finger and says, oh, those guys just don't seem to want to talk about anything because all they care about is the money they're being funded with, so they can't speak against that. But again, it goes back to don't sit passively back and listen to this and blame them. How are you going about finding this out for yourself? You know, certainly I'd like to believe we're putting information out there, but I like to say that we do it in a way that at least it helps you at least get started.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, but it's still like you spent a lot of time educating yourself over many years to learn about the things that you know about that you share with others. What's with this passive attitude that people seem to have? I think sometimes they just... the excuse is, oh, we're just too busy. Well, you won't be busy if you're 6 feet under, that's for sure.
Yes, and to actually answer your question, I did bring, I brought some ammunition for the cause, and I want to mention and cite and absolutely congratulate Dr. Stephanie Seneff. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing her name correctly, her last name. It's S-E-N-E-F-F. She's been doing research on glyphosate, and her research is extensive. She's got a great deal of information that came through a colleague, actually, and this gentleman's name is Anthony Sanso. And I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, S-A-N-S-O, Anthony Sanso. And again, if it's misspelled, Google will correct it. But this is the guy that went to a lot of trouble, painstaking effort to, through the Freedom of Information Act, get information on Monsanto's original research about glyphosate, the glyphosate molecule, and just dug through tons of information and came up with really interesting stuff. I mean, this guy had to dig, but he found it. And I believe he works for the Organic Consumers Organization. He's an attorney for them. But he dug this stuff up, and it actually pointed to where to start looking. And one of the things that he discovered was Monsanto did not allow tests on glyphosate on rats to go beyond 3 months. You know, nothing showed up that was significant, so they just stopped the study at 3 months. And that's because through their own admission, if you let the test go on for 4 months, that's when some real difficulties started showing up. And in rats, the female rat is called a dam, and her offspring are called pups. The first generation, there's not a whole lot going on, but there are some interesting deformities, but none of them are horrific. And this is after you stop feeding the mama rat glyphosate. In the next generation, from the first generation, they're not fed glyphosate either, but it turns out that the children of that first dam, they have reproductive issues, low birth rates, low fertility, and some very interesting birth defects having to do with liver abnormalities and some things that can make a real difference in the health of that rat. And then the next generation has, without any additional glyphosate, these rats are showing horrific birth defects, including baby rats being born with no brains at all. The brain tissue just doesn't develop. And this has already been noticed in Argentina. There's a film out now. It's a documentary. It may be on Netflix, but it's called Genetically Modified Children, and it's what's going on in South America. And now we have about three generations of human beings that the children are being born without brains. And
wow.
Yeah, she pronounces it way better than I do. Anencephaly. Anyway,
okay.
These people, they have no legal way to grow a tobacco crop without using Roundup as an herbicide. And that's what the tobacco company requires. And we got three generations now in South America where this is starting to happen, where we're starting to see it. And
there you go. Let's go ahead. So we have a tobacco company. It's right now, we'll just say it's one tobacco company. Listeners out there, if you use tobacco, find out who this company is and just send letters and say, look, we're not going to buy your products anymore. We're going to go to everybody who has them. We're just not buying them anymore if this is what you're going to allow. That's how you change things.
Exactly.
Don't have to go to your goddamn congressman or any of these people. That'll take forever, and by then you got 9 or 10 more generations going on because these
Correct.
People are more interested in, maintaining their careers. What you do is find out who are they and just go to stores and say, these things will not be bought. Just get them out of here. We're done.
Right.
So.
Right. Yeah, and if you're really interested in tobacco, there's one company out there that actually produces organic tobacco, and that's American Spirit. I don't know too much about him, but I was associated with the original owner. And back when he owned it, not only were they producing organic tobacco, but they were looking for filters that were not cellulose acetate, because it's well known within the industry the most dangerous thing about a cigarette is the filter. Just as a quick aside, you take cellulose fiber, expose it to acetone, and it shrinks all the volatiles off of it. It strips the volatiles out, and you have basically what's a little teeny tiny glass rod. And it's great for absorbing tar and, other chemicals that would be in the tobacco, but it breaks loose and follows the air pathway into the lungs, and it'll go all the way down into those microscopic pockets of the lungs. And that little piece of glass is coated with tar and nicotine and other pyrochemicalized substances that are stuck to it. Anyway, back then, American Spirit was looking for an alternative to that kind of filter. And I think they may have found it, but since I don't smoke, I don't know what's going on.
Too. Just don't smoke a cigarette. Yeah, if you're going to smoke tobacco, do what I do. Have an occasional good cigar, Because
I have
a lot of respect in that energy, just like wine. They don't mess around with GMOs, as far as I know. You know, I mean, they grow it as organically and naturally because it's all about the taste. I mean, this is a call it a higher end client, but these people are very discerning about what they like. You know, what's wrong with a cigar every once in a great while versus packs of cigarettes, kind of a thing. No, I totally hear you there.
And there's no filter on a cigar.
I'm, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you know that, and again, you're bringing up vote with your pocketbook, and that's one of the best ways we can stop the GMOs. That's how they stopped RGBH. You know, nobody wants sex hormones in their kids' milk. You know, much less, you know, future generations.
Well, that and just stop drinking milk. I mean, I've actually replaced milk, you know, using almond milk or coconut milk, and I haven't noticed really that much of a difference. And I actually, my parents lived across the street from a producing dairy, and it's a much different animal to get milk from something like that than what you get in the store. I mean, you're
absolutely.
Just getting it right
absolutely.
Direct. But still, yeah, you got to have concern, you know, as you see the cows being raised. I mean, they were pretty humane about what they did over there, but still, when you're dealing with hundreds and hundreds of cows, it gets kind of dirty over there sometimes.
Oh, it can. It can.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, the industry pushes those animals really hard.
They really do, yeah, all the way around, because I think you have to keep cows basically impregnated so they can produce milk in the first place. And, you know, I'm just simply saying, look, you can discard it because I've made a lot of recipes that require milk. You know, replace it with almond or coconut milk, and I haven't really noticed that much of a difference in how they turn out. So.
Yeah, yeah. And let me say this about coconut oil, since we're kind of on that subject. There was a time when Dr. Oz was really anti-coconut oil. And the backlash.
Yeah, but when is a Dr. Oz against something one way or the other? Guy's doing true crime stories now, for crying out loud. Really?
Oh, really? I don't watch TV either, so I don't know what he's doing.
No, I brush through TV sometimes, and it's really funny how you see people flip-flop and do that. You know, you got shows like The Doctors, and people are actually grabbing the information from these shows and running with it as though it's the gospel truth. I'm just simply saying, if you get the information and you want the gospel truth, get out there and research it for yourself if it directly affects you, you know, sort
right.
of thing. That's what I like to suggest anyway.
Right. Well, the example I was going to give was Dr. Oz almost went off TV because he was anti-coconut oil. And when people saw him doing this and they said, hey, wait a minute, I know some real stuff about coconut oil, and here's the truth. Coconut oil actually is what's called thermogenic. It's a great fat for you to burn. Your body loves it, and it causes you to burn your own fat in order to metabolize and burn coconut oil. So it's one of the best fats around. And the truth of the matter is, and we've been, you know, spoon-fed lies about cholesterol and low-density cholesterol and high-density cholesterol, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Your body, every tissue in your body, prefers to burn fat as fuel. And we don't do it because we've been addicted to carbohydrates and sugar almost all of our lives. But the brain, in particular, likes to burn fat as fuel. And its favorite fat is olive oil. And that's an excellent oil for, you know, brain energy. You don't want to do anything beyond sautéing with olive oil because you can overheat it and smoke it, and then it becomes a rancidified oil, and those are not good for your body. But sautéing is okay because the temperature never goes above 212, you know, provided you're doing, you know, real vegetables. And, you know, you've reached, once your boiling point hits, the temperature is lowered by the exchange of water into steam.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes it safe to saute it with it. But if you're going to fry something, use avocado oil. In the early days, it had a smoke point, verified smoke point of 525 degrees Fahrenheit. They've lowered it a little bit. Now its smoke point is 500 degrees. Which means you're not going to rancidify it. Most frying temperatures are about 325. So you can keep, you know, if you're doing this at home, use your avocado oil because you're not going to ruin it by having it go to its smoke point. But, you know, this again, you know, these oils, they're oils that are good for you, and there's oils that are not good for you, and I'm going to go ahead and mention a few. You know, the people that were behind Dr. Oz bad-mouthing coconut oil was basically the people at the American Heart Association. Now, I don't know that for a fact, but that was the rumor. But this is not a rumor. The American Heart Association was started by the way, the American Heart Association is a non-profit organization. But where did the money come from to start that organization? It came from the canola oil industry. That's who started it. And they're the ones who, you know, oh yeah, you don't you dare eat saturated fat. And you've heard the argument ad nauseum. But the fact is, you have to have a certain amount of saturated fat incorporated in the fat layer in the cell membrane. Cell membrane has an inside membrane, it has the fat layer, and it has the outside membrane. Now, it's really important to know that if you take a very thin oil, like canola oil, after a while it doesn't conduct oxygen from the bloodstream into the cell. And that's because it rancidifies right there in the membrane. Canola oil will rancidify right there in your bloodstream because that's just the nature of that oil. That's why you don't want unsaturated oils, predominant in your diet. You need a certain amount of saturated fat. Saturated fat will actually reject the oxygen and it moves it in the direction to the cell's interior. Oxygen is what a normal cell metabolizes energy with. If it can't get enough oxygen, like for instance if it drops 30% and now you're at a 70% absorption rate, that cell will convert to fermentation in order to keep itself alive. And this is where a cell that's gone over to fermentation becomes a cancer cell. And at that particular juncture, something called apoptosis kicks in. That cell will commit cell suicide. It will activate the genes that will kill that cell. And that always happens unless you cannot activate the genes for apoptosis, and that is entirely governed by that's governed by the absorption of and the presence of iodine and selenium. When those two minerals are deficient, the gene for apoptosis cannot be activated and the cancer cell survives. And once it gets past that stage, it can become a tumor. And that's one of the pathways to cancer, is having those oils cut down on the absorption of oxygen. And the next thing you know, there's a cancer cell and no way for it to shut itself off, which is what it would normally do. But since we're woefully deficient in iodine and almost as deficient in selenium, that's not happening. Anyway, there's the long and short of it for just one cancer pathway.
Wow. You know, it's pretty amazing to think about how simple the path is when you think about it. Here we've got the American Cancer Society and these, you know, millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars they've earned every year from all these fundraisers they're involved with, and yet they don't seem any closer to a cure or at least getting some leverage on it as they were 40, 50, 60 years ago. And
exactly.
It's funny because I was just reading in a magazine. I was at one of those, health food style stores, organic, you know, they mostly sell organic and vegetarian, things like that. And they had this magazine I was reading in there about a woman who was getting treated for cancer, and apparently she was doing it in Mexico. And most of the treatment was around supplementation, not chemicals like chemotherapy, radiation, mm-hmm. things like that, but supplementation. And it reminded me of that movie starring Matthew McConaughey, The Dallas Buyers Club, and that was exactly what he was promoting that was helping people with the AIDS virus, that it was just basically high-grade supplements that was helping these people, you know, at least live longer and healthier lives. In fact,
right.
I think he lived 7 years or so while he was building this whole thing. And it was something that, according to the movie, and I don't know how much of this is the truth or so forth, but anyway, that the FDA was shutting him down and going after him, and all he was doing was just bringing in high-grade supplementation.
Right.
You know, and again, according to the movie, the courts actually went after the FDA and said, you know, okay, we're going to shut him down, but what in the hell are you guys doing? You know, and it was interesting because she says, when she, and back to the lady in the magazine, she She said when she would go and wait, for instance, in a, I think it was a cancer treatment center in America, they had snacks out there available, but she was astounded at the kind of snacks they had out there, you know, crackers, sugar, processed foods. And this is a place you're supposed to be going to apparently treat your cancer.
Right, exactly. And
or back to the Heart Association, if you get their publication, look at the recipes they have in there for people that are supposed to reverse their heart condition. Just it gets
exactly.
silly after a while. So, anyway.
Yeah. And you know, the interesting thing about the form of agriculture that we have, and this is why I wanted to talk about, again, this lady, Vandana Shiva in India. She objected to the first Green Revolution, which was in, I think, the mid-60s on into the 70s, mid-70s, the Green Revolution was really going on. And she saw it not as a way to save her people from starvation because, you know, famine had already been part of their whole culture. But now they're producing food, which it seems like the whole thing is to sell more artificial fertilizer and more toxic rescue chemistry. Well, I wanted to touch on that just briefly because when you grow a crop with the salt-soluble fertilizers, N, P, and K, yes, those are the major plant nutrients. But does anyone ever talk about silica and the role of silica? That's, you know, that goes into the plant stalk. Let's say we're talking about a corn stalk or a stem with wheat at the end of it. When the silica levels are low, the food product itself is low in silica. And, you know, the assumption is always, well, it just needs N, P, and K. You don't really need anything else. But the interesting thing about silica is when there's not enough silica in your diet, it causes breaks in the genetics of your reproductive tissues. And that leads to ovarian cancer and also cancer of the cervix. And that is directly linked to the deficiency of silica, and you've got to have it. And I know a good way for anyone to take a quick look at how much silica they're getting. Look at your fingernails. If you're an older person, you will have these lines that go from the tip of the nail all the way back to the cuticle. And those lines are little ridges, and they'll be parallel to each other. And if those ridges really stand up high, that's a fairly deficient quantity of silica that you've been undergoing. Now, when I first looked at this, my ridges were way high, and I thought, uh-oh, I better do something about this. Okay, I did. I started supplementing with silica. There's a lot of really wonderful silica supplements out there. The horsetail, which is called Epicetum, which has the old-timey name of pot scrubber, grows around creeks. The pioneers used it to scrub frying pans with because it's very high in silica. You can grind that up to a powder. You can take it as a pill, and it's a food source of silica. But also, if you're not a vegetarian, the place where most animals have their silica is in the skin. So always eat the chicken skin, no matter what somebody says, oh, that's where all the cholesterol is. Well, by the way, you need cholesterol. You can only make 80% of what you need, and you have to get the rest of the cholesterol from your diet. So eat the skin, and then the skin is going to be a good source of silica, and it's a food source. Again, we want to try to get our minerals from our food. Now, if you can't do that, supplementation, of course. Don't skip that part because, you know, the foods are woefully deficient in minerals these days. And I've seen charts that show the history of the drop of minerals in our foods. And the more you go to conventional agriculture, the more there's a drop in minerals. But the point I was going to make about the criticism leveled by Vandana Shiva is as the minerals drop in the plant's tissues, its ability to make plant defense chemicals. And these are the things that the plant naturally makes. They're called polyphenols. They're alkaloids. For instance, nicotine is an alkaloid in the tobacco plant, and it is very toxic to insects. And, you know, it's not all that toxic to human beings, and they get addicted to it and all that sort of thing. But to insects, it's deadly. But the polyphenols are the main ones. Those are the colors that show up in fruit. They're called carotenoids. And the reason it has that name, carotenoid, is because the carrot was the first carotenin to ever be studied. And it is a polyphenol. It's a specialized polyphenol. But that orange color, and now carrots come in all colors, but they're all those colors are polyphenols, and they're all plant defense chemicals. They keep that plant safe from insects, safe from environmental hazards like too much ultraviolet. A blueberry is a really good example. The fruit doesn't burn in full sunlight because it's heavy with those pigments that are basically polyphenols. When there's not enough trace minerals, the plant will not be able to make enough polyphenols to defend itself. When it's without its own natural defenses, the insects move in, and then the supposedly prudent farmer moves in with toxic chemicals to kill the insect. Now, the crop's not worth having if it can't even defend itself against insects.
There you go, sort of like the wolves keep the caribou strong kind of a thing.
Exactly. Yeah. The wolf is the strongest thing that ever happened to the caribou populations. And one of the things that I studied at the University of Texas was population and environmental biology. And the example, and this is a classic, you could probably look this up, but when the settlers moved into Colorado, there was a vast forest where the deer were so plentiful that it was just beyond belief. Now, that place was called Estes Park. And someone decided one day that, you know, if there weren't so many wolves, there'd be even more deer. So they put a bounty on wolves.
Yeah, there you
and
go.
For every pair of ears, you could collect them something enormous back then. It's like a dollar. You know, it's like, boy, no one had ever heard of that. So they went out and shot all the wolves they could and brought in the ears. Well, the next thing you know, the population of deer exploded. And the deer are starting to starve to death. In fact, they're so hungry, they're eating the bark off of trees. When that happened, the trees started to die because the trees were using that lignin, which is dependent on, by the way, copper. It couldn't defend itself against other kinds of attack, and the next thing you know, all these aspen trees started to die. Well, the deer population was then beset with deer famine. And the famine itself brought diseases that no one had ever seen into the deer population. And finally someone said, hey, wait a minute, maybe this wasn't such a good idea to kill all these wolves. And so they quit doing that. But what's really interesting about this population study, to this day, the deer populations have not gone back to where they were prior to the extermination of the wolves, because it's taken them that long just to catch back up. Now, they've recovered nicely, but nowhere near what it was in the original populations in Estes Park. And that study is a classic in population and environmental biology.
You know, and some people listening right now to the conversation we're having would say, well, what does this have to do with GMO foods? Well, it has everything to do. It's the complete story of what they call systemic decision. You know, here was a unique one, too, that I found pretty amazing, and this is the coyote population. Now, the same thing was happening with coyotes, very much like the wolves. I figured these animals are a nuisance. Let's just go out and blast them, right? So what had happened was they decided to do this, but here was the strange phenomenon. It was sort of like for every coyote you decided to blow up, five or six more replaced it. And they found the more they were killing these animals, the more their population was increasing, especially in birth rates. You know, and you think, now that's awfully weird when you think about how nature is working there. But, It's basically saying if the coyote is fed, that means there's plenty of food. We don't need as many coyotes out there, I guess, hunting for food. So then the birth population began to decrease.
Right.
So, again, mankind and all of its bravado, logic, and intelligence realized, gee whiz, why don't we just leave, you know, things alone? It obviously knows what it's doing, you know. So that's what all this has to do with GMO and growth and so forth. And really, the reason I like to put behind all of it is, look, was it found there before we came along? If the answer is no, then what do we need it now for? You know,
right.
Obviously in India they have a famine problem. Well, is it just because that you got several million people there? I mean, you might want to consider like cutting down on the birth rate, you know, or something. I don't know, but you know, it's funny how sometimes reasonable a lot of solutions are. And again, going back to it, if you don't like something, sure, protesting is a way you could go, but just simply protest at the cash register. You know, I just
exactly.
won't buy this. It's just really that. What is anybody going to be able to do about that? So.
Yeah, you know, that sends, you know, and one of the food processors high on the list for using GMOs is an outfit called Kraft Foods. And if all of a sudden everybody started boycotting Kraft Foods for using GMO canola oil in all the things they use it in, Kraft would get the message. And the tipping point is 5%. If they lose as much as 5% of their sales, they will wake up and do something about it. And that's the tipping point. That's what Jeffrey Smith pointed out in his movie called Genetic Roulette. And that tipping point was reached very quickly with the RGBH hormone that was being used to produce milk. Boy, as soon as the dairyman caught wind of the fact that the consumer was opposed to it, and they also happened to notice that the cow's hooves were falling apart, it's like, heck, we're not going to use this stuff. And that was the end of it. I don't know that anybody's using RGBH on dairy cattle in the United States anymore. That's the kind of power that the consumer has. And that's why I wanted to say the upliftment, you know, all we have to do is imagine that, yes, we can do this. We can actually totally remove GMOs and all the stupidity that goes with it in the United States simply by foreseeing within our imagination that we can do that. And when we think about it, we'll act on it. And it's that, you know, neighbors talking to neighbors, everybody's saying, hey, you know, I heard this guy on this radio show, and he was talking about how we could get rid of GMOs, and for the first time, I think we can do it. And all
right.
we have to do is start there. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad that we've gotten to this point, because I want to give you a really interesting experiment that I've been doing for about 3 years.
Well, here's probably something later. I wanted to point out, too, just quickly on the track
sure,
that we were
please.
Talking about, George, was this, is a lot of times people individually will look at a problem and they'll see or feel that it's so big, what difference do I make getting engaged in it? Like, that won't change anything, okay? But the fact is, it's like the starfish story where the individual's going along the beach and picking up a starfish and throwing it into the ocean, and here's this person troubled sitting on a cliffside watching this for the longest time and wonders, well, what is this person doing? So they go down and realize this person in the sea of starfish that are up on the beach, and he's picking these starfish up and just simply tossing them into the ocean to save their lives so they don't dry out on the beach. And the person says, well, you know, there's a heck of a lot of starfish here. What makes you think that you're going to be able to save all of them or make any difference at all with what you're doing? I mean, I don't get it. He says, well, let's take a look. He picked up a starfish. He flings it in the ocean. He says, well, I just made a difference to that starfish. That's how big it needs to be. It's just you making that choice. Shouldn't that be a start? Then when
yeah.
you go and talk to people about the fact that you actually feel better, you have more energy, you have a lot more clarity in thinking, there's a positive vibration you feel in your body because of decisions that you've made individually, yeah, there's a very strong likelihood your friend or your neighbor, whoever, is going to say, I wouldn't mind that for myself. How did you do that? See, boom,
right.
That's where the systemic whole thing begins. It begins with you individually making that choice. I remember years ago, I interviewed a wonderful woman who wrote a book called My Bohemia America. And here was someone who was a prominent journalist at making a very good living, but she made a conscious choice that she buys all of her clothes at Goodwill. And I couldn't understand that at first. Then I started thinking, well, you know, if you really don't like these sweatshops, buy secondhand clothes.
Yeah.
So that was a decision she made. She says, it's just something I decide to do. I don't know if it changes the world, but it certainly changes the way that I live in it. There
right.
you go. So
right.
it's just that simple. So you were going to say, George, we got about 5 minutes, so let's go ahead and make it happen.
You bet. Well, here it is. I started doing this about 3 years ago. Every time I get in my car or my truck or some vehicle that I'm going to drive, I imagine that where I live in Austin, Texas, people are becoming more conscientious and more cautious and more considerate of the fact that they're in an automobile that weighs 2 tons, lots of horsepower, very dangerous, and they are becoming more considerate. They're considering their lives, their children's lives, and the lives of other drivers. Now, that's the expectation that I get into a car with. Everybody is actually getting better at this, and they're getting better because they actually care about the other people on the road. Now, this doesn't stop some people from making mistakes. People are going to make mistakes. We're human. We make mistakes. But what I've noticed is people, because of my expectation, and 3 years I'm at it, people are becoming more considerate, more cautious, more able to think about safety on the road. And when you see a big truck trying to change lanes and he's kind of hemmed in, I just drop back and let him get in because I know from having been a commercial truck driver that it's hard to do. I'm seeing other people doing that. They're actually considering the driver of that big truck. And it's amazing to watch. And it's only taken me 3 years to see it happening all around me now. And if more people do it, the better it's going to get. And, you know, really and truly, it's just expecting that your ability to change things is actually influencing everything around you. And especially if it has to do with the health and well-being and safety of our fellow travelers here on Earth.
Mm-hmm. And not to mention, too, when you begin doing it, a really unique phenomenon begins to occur is that you start seeing it happening all around you and you realize, oh, okay, I'm not alone in this. This is possible. And I already feel better.
Right.
It really
yes.
becomes that simple. It isn't you got to go protest in a park. And yeah, if that's what you want to do, fine. Go ahead and do that. But the question is, how immediate do you want results? And we're suggesting you make immediate results occur by the decisions you make as an individual. You start with you. Gandhi even says that, you know. Be
right.
the change you wish to see. It's really just that simple. But sometimes, I don't know, we human beings, and I'm certainly guilty of it occasionally, is we like to complicate stuff. George, I want to thank you so much for being on the program. It's always a pleasure. Is there a way people can find out more about your work, things like that, a website perhaps?
Yes. GeoGrowers, I'm pretty sure it's geogrowers.net. Don't go to .com, go to .net. And we should pop right up. And we've been promoting organics for quite a while. And, you know, even if you're out of our hinterland, too far away for me to ship, and we've shipped as far away as Dallas and Laredo, even though we're far away from you, you can see what's going on and what's happening and what, a dedicated few are able to do. And I want everyone to be encouraged. And I'm seeing some of the greatest, most wonderful changes on the teeniest, tiniest levels. And I'm going to say, keep on going. That's the best message I can give you.
Right. And also to know, look, getting good information has you do what? It has you asking better questions. And when you're asking better questions, you should hopefully have better results. It really is just one foot in front of the other kind of thing. George,
yes.
Again, thank you for being on the program today. And one
you're
more
welcome.
Time for the listeners, go ahead and give out that website.
Sure. It's geogrowers.net, and then there's one called dispatch at geogrowers@gmail.net. There we go. That's the, one of the ones. I got a couple of email addresses, and you can contact us, and we'll do our best to get back to you.
All right. Thank you again, George, for being on the program today.
Thank you. All right. We'll talk soon.
You bet. We want to thank you, the listeners out there, for joining us. You can also discover more at beyond50radio.com. That is the number 50. We do encourage you to sign up for our weekly e-newsletter to keep up to date with what's going on in the world of Beyond 50, as well as our upcoming shows. I'm Daniel Davis. Thank you for joining us. This is the Beyond 50 Radio program, and remember, live your day past halfway.